Dan Gaynor on the line with us. He is the T. Boone Pickens Fellow and Vice President of the Business and Media Institute. Businessandmedia.org is the website. Liberals cash in on their own brand of hate. Dan, did you really write this?
Yes, I did. For the record, I would not put you into that category.
Who is?
Oh, well, let's start with Keith Olbermann. We could stop there, too, but we could start with Keith Olbermann. I mean, he's made a career, his second career, because I liked him as a sportscaster. He's made a career out of the worser people of the day. You know, the week, the month, the year, the worst person in the world. Come on. You know, then you got Perez Hilton, who's, the way he treated Carrie Prejean is just despicable. We see all the time in the news, conservatives are supposed to be big-time haters. But, you know, it sure looks like there's a huge target market on the left for
Dan, I
got to
tell you, I watch Keith Olbermann's show pretty much every day, and I don't think I've ever seen anything that I would call hateful. He's a strong defender of the Constitution. He's a strong defender of the rights of the underdog. He's telling the news. He points out a lot of hypocrisies on the right. You know, like Sean Hannity saying that he would be waterboarded for charity and then wimping out and being a coward. I guess calling Hannity a coward, if you want to call that hate, but that's nothing compared to the stuff that was going on at the Palin rallies where people were yelling about killing Obama.
First of all, people yelling from the crowd, you never even know when people, you know this, when people post on your website, you don't know whether they're conservative or liberal. People
okay, all out, right, I'll give you that, let's move to something a little more substantive if we can, okay, because I think we're just going to go in circles on this one. The front page of today's Financial Times, and this concerns me. Tremendously, and also Louise and I watched 60 Minutes last night. Same thing. 60 Minutes did a show that was basically, oh my God, if we don't let Chinese steal into the United States, Caterpillar is going to go out of business. And here we are in the front page of the Financial Times, a $787 billion stimulus bill, and the Buy American provision, and they're all hysterical about this. And then we discover that GM, General Motors, this from the NZ Herald, the New Zealand Herald. General Motors plans to sell cars in the United States that it makes in China. The upcoming Chevy Spark will be built in South Korea. They're talking about importing tens of thousands of cars into the United States, 17,335 from China in 2011. Now, of course, it's going to be about 2% of their total production, but still, why does not the right join those of us on the left? And frankly, I think it would be a minority in both cases, because I know Pat Buchanan on the right agrees with me on this, in saying, let's go back to the plan that Alexander Hamilton put into place and suggested in 1791, became law in 1793, and stood until, Richard Nixon started talking about it, but Ronald Reagan and then George Herbert Walker Bush and Bill Clinton in particular took a meat axe to protectionism. I'll just use the word. I'm a protectionist.
Yeah, well, first of all, I think you and I are going to agree on some parts of this and disagree on other parts of this. We don't play by the same rules that other countries play by. And if we play,
play by stupid rules.
Where you and I would agree, I think, is that we should hold other countries to the rules they hold us. China, for instance, pays no attention to copyright, trademark, patents, or anything else. We should hold their feet to the fire on that issue because they're ripping us off to the tune of billions.
Well, and they're manipulating their currency, and they've got the equivalent of import tariffs. I mean, it is so hard to import U.S. made goods into China. In some cases, there are overt tariffs, like on cars, it's a 20% tariff if you want to import a car into China. But in most cases, it's just all these regulatory barriers that you have to leap through, which is the game that Japan played with us for 40 years. South Korea is continuing to do. Japan is continuing to do. Taiwan is continuing to do. Many European countries, oddly enough, are continuing to do. It's hard to export U.S. goods. And yet we say to all of those countries, yeah, bring your stuff in here. We don't need no stinking jobs.
Right. No, like I said, that's the part where you and I agree. Now, here's the part where we disagree. The idea of Buy American, theoretically, if you just say you're going to buy an American car or whatever the heck that means anymore, or you're going to buy an American stereo or whatever, and I am too, but we're choosing to personally do it, great. That was the big thing in the 70s and the 80s. buy American. I'm all for that if people want
to
do
it. Well, in the 70s, we still had tariffs, and in the early 80s, we still had, you know, the average tariff in the United States was in the low 20s.
But now
it's in 2%.
But mandating the Buy American provisions in the new Obama stimulus package, what it's doing is sparking a trade war with, of all countries, Canada. You know how difficult it is for us to have, like, anything involving a war with China, you know, trade war or anything. They're good neighbors. We get along with them real well. And so,
but that doesn't mean we should send our jobs to them, Dan.
But at the same time, it does. I mean, we do have trade agreements with them, including NAFTA. You know, that. And so,
wait a minute. I thought you loved your country. Don't you want to put America first?
Put America first. If it ends up hurting America, no. What we're doing is...
keeping American jobs in America help America?
Because what we're ending up doing exactly with Canada. We've got companies that ship things to Canada that the Canadians are now saying, well, they're not going to buy because of the Buy American provision. They're responding.
Dan, do you know what percentage of our total gross domestic product is exports?
I'm going to let you tell me, because I don't know the percentage.
It's 4.6%.
Okay.
And you know, from throughout the 20th century, it has varied from a low of 2.4% during the Great Depression to a high of around 5%. But imports is huge. I don't have the numbers on imports right in front of me. I don't want to quote an imprecise number, but it's in the double digits. And what we have in the United States is folks like yourself right now defending using this teeny teeny tiny export sector to defend trade laws that make for a huge import sector. We've become the world's largest importer of manufactured goods. That's and the world's largest exporter of raw materials. That makes us a third world nation. We don't make things here anymore. And we're not going to change that until we change our trade policy.
But if you saw the 60 Minutes piece.
I did.
Saw a company that actually was functioning great prior to the credit problem. So they had no problems. They're a steel company. Steel was working great.
Right.
They figured out a technological solution to the problems they have with, you know, Chinese steel. Everything is working fine. The only reason they're having problems is credit problems. They're not having problems because of cheap Chinese steel.
And that company is in favor of protectionist labor or protectionist laws. It was Caterpillar that was opposed to the protectionist laws. And what Leslie Stahl did not point out in that story was that one of the biggest competitors with Caterpillar is it Hyundai? I forget which one it is. It's one of the South Korean companies. They make a huge quantity of heavy earth moving equipment and tractors and other things that we buy here in the United States. And if we stopped importing those things to the United States, Caterpillar could make a very good business just here in the U.S.
But we have trade agreements all around the world. So
which is nuts.
What you're talking about, and we're part of a global economy. We can choose to like it or choose to dislike it, but it's still a fact.
We can choose to change it, too.
Well, I mean, but we can't change that we're part of a global economy. We can change how we deal with that, but we're still...
Point
taken.
What
you're talking about doing is putting our companies, and in many cases our workers, at a detriment compared to foreign workers.
I am, yes. In the case of those 4.6% of our GDP that has to do with exports, yes, absolutely. I am saying... Put them at a disadvantage. Reduce our export business down to, you know, the 2 or 3% that it historically was, and say to people in the export business, you know, if you really want to have an export-driven business, maybe you should do something else, like sell things to be made in America. And let's take the part of our business that has gone. We no longer make clothing in the United States. We no longer make computers in the United States. We no longer make televisions in the United States. We no longer make radios in the United States. Let's bring those things home.
Well, I mean, this is the same mistake we made in the 30s with Smoot-Hawley.
Smoot-Hawley took international trade from around 3.5% to 2.4%. It had virtually no impact on trade. The larger impact on trade was the Depression itself.
It's one of the impacts. But you don't, when you've got a down economy, you don't make trade difficult. That's what you're
talking
about.
Yes, you do.
Talking about piling on all sorts of regulations and rules that would eliminate our trade with all sorts of countries.
Yes,
or make it
That's what I want to do. I want to say to General Motors, sorry, we're not going to, you know, you want to make cars in China, sell them in China.
I think that's a Luddite position.
Sign me up! Mr. Luddite, here I am. I confess. Dan Gaynor, you've called me out. Businessandmedia.org is the website. Thanks, Dan.
Take care.
Good talking to you.